all so much for coming. It's really wonderful to see so many people here. I'm Dana Murchison. I'm a staff scientist at Science North, and tonight I get to be your moderator for our Science Café. And tonight's topic is conflicts in conservation. Should we save the parasites? Move this to the side. Maybe that'll help. I actually think parasites are super cool. I kind of always have. And I was like enthusiastically like, yes, absolutely, we should save the parasites. And then last week I saw a super long tapeworm and it was really gross. And it temporarily changed my mind a little bit, but that's okay. Tonight we're gonna hear kind of both sides of that argument and a lot more. So it's a really interesting topic. I actually wasn't super familiar with the idea of a conflict around whether or not we should be conserving kind of all species, including parasites. So this topic actually kind of came up through conversations with the Center for Evolutionary Ecology and Ethical Conservation, SEEK, who are our partners for this Science Café this evening, and actually who are not at all new to partnering with us on events like this. So those of you who have been here multiple times, you may have seen a few events going back to November 2013 that we've worked on together. On a ton of different topics. So SEEK is a research unit at Laurentian University. They're doing really, really cool interdisciplinary work in biology and philosophy of species and conservation. I know there's a number of people from SEEK here tonight as well. So, and I'm just gonna pass over to Albrecht to say a couple of words on behalf of SEEK as well.
Does that sound okay?
It's ringing a little bit. Yeah. Thanks everybody for coming. This is a great example of the kinds of partnerships that our research center is trying to develop in the community, and Science North has been great in terms of helping us get out the word on the kinds of work that we do. We're interested in questions that are integrating philosophy and ethics with questions of evolution and conservation, and we've done several projects or several sort of science cafes related to extinction, and we did one last year on evolutionary medicine, and then this one on this sort of conservation, problems in conservation. Our research is focused on a number of different areas, often related to specifically to conservation, some of it related to philosophy, specifically to environmental philosophy, but also integrating those two perspectives. And we are basically a group of academics at Laurentian, three biologists and two philosophers that are enjoying each other's sort of company and having fun doing interesting projects. And this is an example of the kinds of things that we like to do. So I think that's basically all I have to say. Thanks.
Thanks. Awesome. So as Albert said, it's just a really, really fun partnership because we get to geek out about a bunch of really cool topics. This particular topic Albrecht sent my way, it was this idea that sometimes when we're trying to conserve a species, we actually wind up putting other species at risk. So the excellent example that I always think about is the condor louse. So biologists were able to save the California condor, but they drove this specific kind of louse, you know, lice, to extinction that only lives on California condors. I don't know if it only lives on the heads of the condors or their whole
Most
body.
People would know about head lice.
Yeah, yeah. So it's, you know, it's like head lice that are human lice, right? But that was a specific kind of parasite that could only survive on the California condor. So, you know, in that case, when you're gonna weigh those two species, you know, how do you decide which one is worth saving? What do you do? I think sometimes we tend to pick the cuter one, and actually when we had a science cafe in November 2013, it was about species triage in part, and we talked about whether or not people tend to choose to pick the cuter species to conserve, but there's a lot of questions like that. So what we really value when it comes to biodiversity, and you know, what kinds of things matter to us when we're looking at making some of these really difficult decisions. So we have a really great panel today that's going to kind of address some of those questions. So I will introduce our awesome panel. We're gonna start off by hearing from Dawn Bazely. Some of you might have heard her on CBC just before you showed up here. So Dawn's coming to us today from York University. She's just kind of up specifically for the Science Cafe, so we're really grateful to her for making the trip. She's a professor of biology in the Faculty of Science at York University. She's taught there since 1990. She's a past director of IRIS, which is the York University-wide Institute for Research and Innovation and Sustainability. Her mission there was to develop, lead, and support interdisciplinary research on a bunch of diverse fronts, and actually Dawn's done a ton of interdisciplinary work, so that's one of our favorite words at Science Cafes, so we're really, really happy that she's here. She's done a ton of different kinds of field work, she received a Charles Bullard Fellowship from Harvard University in 2011 to work on a book looking at conservation and ecological issues in Southern Ontario. And she's looking at it from a scientific policy and also political perspective. So she's gonna be an excellent, excellent member of our panel. So thank you, Dawn, for being here. Second, we're going to hear from Albrecht, Schulte-Hostedde. Albrecht is a professor in the Department of Biology at Laurentian University, and he's a member of SEEK. He's also a Canada Research Chair in Applied Evolutionary Ecology. So Albrecht's work is focused on improving the conservation of Canadian animal species by looking at evolutionary ecology principles. He's looking into studying ecology and taking into account the evolutionary histories of species in order to answer a number of issues involving conservation. So he's going to speak for us second. This is actually Albrecht's third turn as a Science Café speaker, for which we're incredibly grateful, and on three very, very different topics. So you're going to get to see a brand new side of Albrecht this evening, so thank you. And finally, we're going to hear from Gillian Crozier. Gillian's also a member of SEEK at Laurentian University. She's an associate professor in the Department of Philosophy at Laurentian, and she is also a Canada Research Chair in Environment, Culture, and Values. So Gillian's research, she works on the philosophy of science and using philosophy of science to study cultural evolution. So her research focuses on analyzing relationships between environmental and cultural factors using real-world examples and exploring moral aspects of international healthcare. So Gillian's actually spoken for us twice and helped us co-organize twice as well. So again, on two very, very different topics. So we're really, really grateful to have her here. And Albrecht and Gillian have just been fantastic to work with to put this event together. So thank you both to both of them. So before I pass the mic over, just for those of you who haven't been to a Science Café before or might not have been to one in a while, I'll just give you a little bit of a taste of kind of what's to come. So we're going to hear from each of our three speakers for kind of 8 to 10 minutes, just kind of a quick way of laying the groundwork for what we're going to talk about tonight. Then after that, we're going to have a little bit of a break. There's going to be some snacks that are going to come out for those of you who might have gotten peckish over that kind of first portion. You have evaluation forms on your tables, or for those of you who don't have them, I would really, really like it if you came and grabbed one from me afterwards to fill out and tell us what you liked and what you didn't like. If you do have one on your table, if there's something that comes up kind of that you want to ask the panel about later, you can jot it down on the back as kind of notes for yourself. And then after the break, we're going to come back and we're going to do some moderated discussion. So I'm going to be out and about in the audience kind of moving the mic around and getting your thoughts, because really we want to hear from you. We are both audio and video recording this event for posterity, so, smile for the cameras. And there is actually a photographer who's roving around as well. Smile if you see him. If you do want to kind of join the conversation and you're not really interested in stepping up to the mic, I will also be checking Twitter. So if you tweet, which all of our speakers do tonight, you can check out the hashtag SNSciCafe, and I'll be following the tweets on there as well. So if there's a question that comes up that you'd like me to ask the panel, or a question that you'd like me to ask the audience, because I really want to get your perspectives as well, by all means, tweet it, and I will be checking throughout the night. So without further ado, I'm going to pass it on to Dawn. Thanks.
Thanks very much, and I want to say thank you very much for the invitation. I have to say this. I got a back injury last April, and I haven't, and it means that I now have a standing desk and I can't really sit. I was rear-ended in a car and my whole back just gave out. So I haven't been able to get further than 2 hours from Toronto for 9 months. So coming here is a really big deal. I've been saying, oh my God, I've got a sunburn, awesome. Okay, so.
We like it when people get excited about coming here.
Oh yeah. The last time I was here was December 2013, the weekend before Christmas, and that huge snowstorm. So, yep, so this is much more pleasant today than then. Okay, so should we save all the parasites? So one of the things that I do in my lab is I work on grasses. So I don't work on all these cute, charismatic species, like these cute little squirrels and stuff like that. I'm basically a grass biologist. And I work on grasses, which it was discovered about 25, 30 years ago, Many of them have this fungus that lives inside the grass. And if you're a plant and something is going to eat you, you can't actually run away. So you've got to sit there and take it. So over time, many plants have evolved defensive mechanisms that will make them unappealing to a grazing animal like a sheep or some other vegetarian. Thorns, spines, prickles, or poisons, you know, alkaloids, things that are, you know, plant poisons are so interesting. And often the topic of Murdoch mysteries and stuff like that. There was one about opium recently about plant alkaloids. But it turns out that there's many, many grasses actually have got a fungus that was completely invisible to the outside world, which is providing the fungus makes the poison, which when the grazing animal, whether it's a sheep or a horse or a cow, eats the grass, can the impact could vary from sublethal, so just make them quite sick, to kill them. So so this is pretty, pretty cool. It's a mutualistic, positive relationship. The grass gives the fungus a place to live, and the fungus provides poisons that deter animals, and animals will learn to avoid grasses that are producing these alkaloids. Except that when you look at the evolutionary history, that fungus started out as a parasite or a pathogen of the grass. So over time, this fungus that was actually, and you can see the evolutionary relationship as many, many grass cereals like barley, they'll often get this fungus that will grow into the seed. So instead of the kernel of barley or wheat, it will be the fungus. And some of you may have heard of the Salem witch trials, for example, and it's actually thought that one of the reasons why that happened is that the community was eating bread that was made from rye that was somehow that this ergot of rye alkaloid had kind of gotten in from this fungus into the flour, and people were acting a little bit crazy. So this is the ancestor of this. And so I think that that something that can start out as a parasite, relationships change. So if you're going to say, let's get rid of all the parasites, you could actually be removing species from systems that are going to have some kind of evolving relationship that will provide a benefit at some point in the future. And we don't really know what that is. I would also say that in this room, we're all eukaryotes. So we've actually got cells that have got organelles. We've got mitochondria. We don't have chloroplasts. We should, because I believe we should all be plants and photosynthesize. But we have nuclei. And it's pretty clear from some of the research now, all this cool new genetic sequencing, and we're getting new ideas of evolutionary relationships. We're very closely related to fungi, by the way. You have more in common with a mushroom than you do with a lot of other species. But it's quite clear that the way that we evolved, our life form evolved, was probably from some kind of two cells coming together, that there may have been a parasitic relationship, and then you got us. So yeah, I think that I just want to put out here that there, in these longer term scenarios, things can change, and something that's an enemy or something bad could become something that's more of a friend, and you don't really know. And if you try to eradicate, and by the way, eradicating things, we have eradicated some diseases, we hope, but eradication is a pretty difficult option. So I'm just going to leave it at that and say, yes, many grasses are very grateful to their friend, which is the fungus that can't be seen, that will kill grazing horses and cows, because it means the grass survives to grow another leaf. But it started out as a parasite.
Okay, thank you.
So when I approached Dana about this idea behind this science cafe, I had the main idea that had come to my mind was this interesting juxtaposition in terms of sort of society's attitudes towards biodiversity. And the first thing was that we all agree that we should conserve biodiversity. That is, that it's bad when species go extinct. We don't want species to go extinct. Lots of money is spent on trying to prevent species from going extinct. But it's interesting that we often also celebrate extinction. And so I think about things like guinea worm, which is a fairly awful parasite that lives in Africa, which infects people. And Jimmy Carter, the former US president, is heading a very large effort to try to drive it to extinction. We drive it to extinction because it harms people. But it's not, I just found it interesting that we juxtapose the sort of general celebration of, you know, conservation of biodiversity against something like that. And even more recently, like the Zika virus, which has caused so much trouble in Brazil and so on, you know, there's discussions about trying to drive the vector of that virus into extinction, this sort of Egyptian mosquito that is the vector for this disease and other diseases. We should, you know, there are calls to try to rid ourselves of this species of mosquito or perhaps other species of mosquito. And why would we, you know, this is an interesting contradiction with respect to our general ethos of, you know, trying to conserve biodiversity. And so I think, you know, that's a conversation that's worth having. And, you know, you can understand, you know, perhaps we want to get rid of the animals and plants and insects and other, you know, organisms that harm people, but where do we draw the line, right? So, you know, sure, some people get eaten by lions. Do we want to drive lions to extinction? I mean, this is an extreme case, but you get my point, right? Like, where is the line between what, where we celebrate an extinction, where we, you know, celebrate sort of conservation of biodiversity? The other issue is sort of related to the conservation of biodiversity in the context of, in my case, I do some work with zoos, and you know, efforts to try to prevent extinction often involve captive breeding programs where you bring in animals that are endangered, you bring them into the zoo environment, you breed them, and then eventually you're going to release them into the wild, right? So lots of examples of this kind of thing. Vancouver Island marmots, black-footed ferrets, these kinds of charismatic animals, most of them hairy or feathery. But there's stories, right? Like the condor, there's another example of black-footed ferret. There's a flea that lives on the black-footed ferret that is exclusively found on this black-footed ferret. And these well-meaning veterinarians that brought in these black-footed ferrets into captivity, they wanted the black-footed ferrets to be healthy. And so what did they do? They killed all the ectoparasites that are on these black-footed ferrets, because these black-footed ferrets have to be healthy in order for them to be in these captive breeding programs. Well, when they did that, what did they do? They drove this species of flea into extinction. The flea disappeared. So it's, you know, these kinds of, I find these questions that are, you know, about, you know, what do we value? Do we value the flea over the, you know, the ferret? And if we do, why? It seems that we do, right? So what is it about these sort of furry animals that makes us value them more than perhaps, you know, these sort of, in this case, these are parasites that we may not value, but they do have a role to play. And in fact, most species on the planet are parasitic, at least at some point in their life history. So anyway, those are the questions that I've pondered. There's no answers. There's no real answers, unless Gillian might have the answers. But I certainly don't. But I certainly think that they're interesting questions to ask. And I talk to my kids about them, and they don't have much of an answer. So maybe you guys will have a better one.
Thanks, Albrecht.
That's what philosophy is all about. You know, I'm going to be speaking from my training, which is as a philosopher and a bioethicist, but I don't have a lot to say. I just want to sort of direct attention at certain things that I think are probably going to be relevant as the conversation moves forward. And can you guys hear me okay? Is that better? Okay, I'll aim for this. As Albrecht mentioned, one of the things that we really have to pay attention to is what is being valued, why is that being valued, and how do you weight various values and various interests that we might have, and that other creatures might have. So I think one of the things that you need to take into consideration when you're doing these sorts of evaluations surrounding conservation is, such as when you have this, the louse, the condor louse and the condor, you're talking about, preserving one species at the expense of another. So you're looking at group versus group. How do you calculate the interests of those groups? Do they even have any? How do you calculate our interests vis-a-vis those groups? Do we want to preserve biodiversity for specific aims, or do we want to do it just because it's generally preserving what economists refer to as an option value to use this stuff in the future? I think that's sort of what Dawn was getting at when she was saying you never know how these relationships are going to evolve. And to some extent, you don't know what relationships already exist that you might be disrupting if you remove one factor from the ecosystem. That's certainly an important thing to take into consideration, but on the other side, you have to also consider that there are, in many cases, animals involved in these decisions that can suffer in ways that are important, less so than grass. So it's a little bit simpler when you're talking about non-sort of cognitively sophisticated animals. But one of the things that comes into play when you are talking about, you know, comparing the interests of condors versus louses is that you do have these charismatic megafauna, but sometimes this charismatic megafauna concept really is standing in as a proxy for something that we actually do care about on a fairly fundamental level, which is that we identify in these other species and in the other individuals in these communities the capacity to suffer, the capacity to feel pleasure and pain, the capacity to have experiences and interests of their own that it might or might not be permissible to disrupt. So if, for example, you have a situation where there's, hypothetically, I think Dawn and Albrecht will have real cases of this in mind, but where you have diseased wild populations and doing some kind of culling of the diseased organisms in those populations are conducive to the long-term viability of those populations, under what circumstances are those kind of culling operations permissible? To some extent, the interests of the organism, you can argue, are tied up in the interests of their own population insofar as they have families and offspring within those populations. That's an argument that can be made. I don't know if you find it compelling, but when you're talking about sacrificing organisms in one species for the sake of preserving another species, then that argument disappears. So I just want to make sure that the interests of the individual organisms, A, are not completely falling off the radar in this conversation, but also just makes sure that we're sort of bearing in mind that sometimes these interests don't just have one measurement. Sometimes there are different things that we're valuing. Sometimes once we articulate them, some of those things are more justifiable than other things. And I think I'll just stop there for now.
Thank you.
All right, so we definitely have a lot to think about over the break. We're going to have some snacks coming out at the back very briefly. And then after that, I'm going to be kind of roving around and looking for questions from the audience. So think about what your most burning questions for our panel are, or to throw to the audience as well. Okay, we'll see you back in about 10 minutes. So up front here, we had a very lively discussion over the break. We chatted about a couple of things, and actually one of the questions that came up is one that I kind of wanted to use to just start off the conversation for the second half of the evening. We were talking about viruses. So if we talk about preserving biodiversity, and you know, if we don't want to eradicate mosquitoes just because they may, you know, carry Zika virus, for example, what about the Zika virus itself? So does the virus count as part of that kind of biodiversity that we want to preserve? So I'm going to throw that question to our panel to start us off, and then I'm going to be roving around in the audience. So if you do have a question, if there's something you want to throw either to the audience or to the panel, just catch my eye. I'll come over. I'll bring you the mic. I'm going to ask that we do use the mic for our comments and questions just so that we can capture it for the podcast audio. So maybe our panel can start us off. Are viruses a part of the kind of biodiversity that we want to be able to preserve? I'm curious. Gillian drew the short straw here.
Okay. Can you hear me okay? Okay, so there are lots of different reasons to preserve biodiversity and lots of different measures of biodiversity. So it kind of depends on what you are looking for. But if we go on that option value notion where we're just trying to preserve as much information about how biological things interact with the environment that has developed over the course of evolutionary history, and we want to just keep that around in case it's useful at some point, then I don't see why we would want to cut off the line at the between viruses and bacteria, just because there's a sort of squishy question about what counts as life. That being said, you know, I think we would want to make sure those things are locked away, like in, what are they, like
level four.
like zombie lockdown kind of virus preservation.
So we were talking about this because I said, well, is a virus alive? Which technically it really isn't. And when we're teaching this, of course, a virus takes over the cellular machinery to do its thing. But there's genetic information, Gillian said, but there's genetic information there. And I said, yeah, so when we've eradicated smallpox, there are these vials, and then it gets turned into a movie, like these Seven Monkeys movies, you know, about epidemics and World War Z and stuff like that. But I think that in those movies, the scientists always want to preserve one vial of this virus. So, and then bad stuff happens. So does that mean that are scientists stupid or something? I don't know. Maybe I don't think I'm qualified to answer this question about viruses versus anything else.
I just want to jump the queue on this and say that one of the, because I did look into the smallpox preservation thing, one of the justifications for holding on to the smallpox virus is that we don't know for sure that the quote-unquote good guys are the only ones who have access to it. So the idea is that you want to have the justification is you want to have a sample of it somewhere where you can get access to it in case somebody else turns it into a chemical biological weapon so that you can try to figure out some way of fighting the effects. That's part of the justification, whether you buy it or not.
So I'm just curious about that. So you couldn't just sequence the genome of the smallpox virus and do the same thing?
I don't know that, I don't know that when they actually dug up the virus and put it in on ice, that was a viable option at the time. But I just don't know. I don't know. That would be a question for biologists.
And how convenient that we have two biologists right here.
Okay, so, you know, my first question about viruses is, you know, does it count as biodiversity, as we said? And how do we define what biodiversity is? Are viruses alive or not? That's, I don't know if it's quite as definitive as Dawn said. I think there's some debates as to whether a virus is actually alive. It does carry genetic information. If, you know, not all viruses are lethal, clearly. Many viruses are, in fact, integrated into your own genomes, in fact. So a lot of human DNA, for example, is actually made up of DNA, viral DNA sequences that have amalgamated themselves inside your DNA over evolutionary time. So, you know, do we want to eradicate viruses that might kill us, perhaps? That sounds like a good idea. But I think the question isn't quite as easy as one would think, at least initially.
If I could jump in here. A while ago, there was this
sort of factoid making the rounds that 99% of the cells in the human body aren't actually human cells. They're microbial cells, but there was a paper recently came out that says it's a good thing 50% of the cells in our body that we carry around are in fact human cells, and 50% are microbes. So they're not running us quite, our bacterial overlords, not quite as bad as, so even if we, I mean, like, you're looking at each other, but actually half of you is some kind of germ. So this is, sorry about that, but yeah.
Actually, if I can just jump in on that, I read a few things about that paper as well, because we love microbes at Science North, right? And one of the coolest factoids I saw about that was that some people are speculating that every time you poop, actually, you shift the balance, so you win. I just thought that was a lovely little factoid. So you get a small victory every day against your microbes. Are there any questions from the audience? On that delightful note, I'm sorry. Some of you are eating. I'm sorry. That's terrible. Okay, we've got one at the back. Fantastic. Oh, sorry. I saw it.
Thanks, Una. So if we were having this discussion 60, 70 years ago, which is not very long ago, the topic might not be parasites, but predators. The way we looked at wolves back then was that they were a negative because they ate a lot of deer and so on. And what has changed is that the animal hasn't evolved, but our science has improved dramatically to understand the relationship in the landscape. This flea on the condor, for example, there's a species of beetle just found on beaver fur. Whether they actually cause harm to the animal is still debatable, but because it's what looks to be a parasite, we'd like to think let's eliminate it because it's parasitic or it's there feeding on the skin of the animal. I'd like to think that our science hasn't evolved enough to truly understand that role, and perhaps they are a key element of the ecosystem. Perhaps they build the immune system of the animal. Just like wolves changed the landscape of Yellowstone when they were reintroduced. From meadows and returned back to forest. Who would have ever guessed that? So there is, if we assume then that our logic would suggest that our science will be better able for us to understand in the future the role of fleas and parasites, perhaps we should hold some back just so that we can better understand that relationship. And comments?
That wolves in Yellowstone video, best video ever. I think it's got millions of hits on YouTube. But yeah, I totally agree. And actually, Charles tweeted a question, which was, do we have his question? Can we?
Yes, we do. One moment while I consult the internet. So Charles's question was, what would the world look like without the selective pressures of parasites and pathogens?
Right, so we were talking a little bit about that, and it sort of relates to your comment, which was that one of the things, of course, is our immune systems are constantly challenged, and we know that these days, and we have a small child here, we know that our immune system is, it's we need to be constantly exposed. We've evolved with these pressures. And there are some thoughts in the parenting books these days that our children are in an environment that is too clean, and that you actually, the idea that dirt is a good thing, so what would it look like without all of these selective pressures? I think there's some suggestions that your immune system isn't as strong, and and we need it. So I'll let you've got more to say on that.
So actually, that's a good point. Actually, the role of parasites and pathogens in terms of our own immune systems is relatively not well understood, but there is something called the hygiene hypothesis, which some of you may be familiar with, which is the hypothesis that it argues that a lot of the prevalence of autoimmune diseases that we see in human populations, things like allergies and things of that nature, inflammatory bowel disease and things like that are the result of living in an environment which is devoid of parasites and pathogens. So people who have Crohn's disease and things of that nature, they're actually being treated with pig whipworms. So they infect a person who has Crohn's disease with a whipworm, and that induces the immune system to increase the amount of mucus, I think, in the gut, and this protects the gut from sort of the erosion that occurs because of this disease. So it's essentially an autoimmune disease that can be treated with a parasite. I have a mother-in-law actually who has some autoimmune disorders, and I suggested this to her, that she should get herself a gut worm, some kind of parasite. She was not terribly pleased with that suggestion, as you can imagine. But it is certainly a viable treatment, and one that, you know, people are using. And so as a complete aside, I'll give you an idea that I've tried. I haven't been able to test this, but it's something I'm looking into in my lab. So I alluded to this question of the issue about, you know, endangered species coming into zoos and having them essentially be inoculated and vaccinated against all kinds of diseases and parasites and pathogens. And so, in fact, black-footed ferrets in the Toronto Zoo, for example, live in a virtual bubble. They live in an isolated facility that people are not allowed to walk in there unless they, you know, wear scrubs. They have to wash in, wash out. These animals are kept in relatively sterile conditions. They are, as I said, vaccinated against disease. They are medicated all the time. And I have this idea that maybe some of these animals are experiencing autoimmune diseases because their immune systems are not being challenged by the kinds of parasites and pathogens that they are adapted to fight off. And so when the immune system doesn't have anything to fight, what does it do? It turns on itself, and so it attacks the tissues of the body. So the parasites and pathogens that we have in our environment then may play a very important role in terms of maintaining our immune systems and preventing the kinds of autoimmune diseases that we might see, that we certainly see in higher prevalence in Western countries.
Fantastic. Other questions? There was one over here previously. Question?
Not so much a question as a cautionary note or observation. We as human beings always are looking for the easy fix. So we get individuals that get sick from whatever. Rather than addressing that issue, we want to destroy whatever it is that causes it. And here's the example I use. And I was in my 20s, just a personal story. I was in my 20s. My girlfriend and I had something, and I've got something on for the first time in 21 years. But anyhow, my girlfriend and I had something, and she had some antibiotics for whatever we had. At some point, she said, oh, I said, do you want to take some too? And I said, I don't know where this came from. No thanks, the little buggers mutate faster than we do. Now, I use that as a metaphor for everything we deal with. Do we really want to start a war with the microcosmic world? No.
So I can speak to that. That's a good question, actually. And so there's a whole area of research looking at the consequences of vaccination. And I'm not speaking about, like, I'm not an anti-vaxxer. Vaccinate your kids. You know, you need to do all that. But we do need to be mindful about the evolutionary consequences of vaccination. And one of the evolutionary consequences of vaccination is an increase in virulence. That is the negative effects that a disease might have or a pathogen might have on its host. That will increase, or it can increase, I should say, under situations in which a population of hosts has been vaccinated. And there's lots of modeling being done right now. I know a colleague of mine at Queen's, Troy Day, is working on this, and there's a few others that work on these kinds of questions. But there are evolutionary consequences to our public health interventions that look at trying to, you know, minimize harm to the population, human population, from diseases and pathogens. But we do have to be mindful that what we might be doing might be actually increasing the harm that could be caused by some of these pathogens. Not to say that we shouldn't be, you know, vaccinating our kids and doing all those things, because we certainly don't want them to die. But we have to be mindful, and I think that, you know, in terms of public health, there are questions that need to be answered in terms of what are the consequences of vaccination. And moving forward, we know that, you know, for example, these sort of bacteria and viruses, their generation times are very, very rapid. They can evolve very quickly. And so we need to be prepared for the, you know, some of the consequences of our public health actions like vaccination. Again, please, I'm not being an anti-vaxxer at all, but just simply saying that there are consequences to vaccination from an evolutionary perspective that we need to be mindful of.
And also selecting the problems that we're now seeing with the rise of antibiotic-resistant bacteria, and of course we've got people not completing courses of antibiotics, and there really is a big hunt on now for new kinds of antibiotics because we're running out of really effective ones. And this is interesting, you know, when people have a virus and they go to the doctor and they say, I want an antibiotic, and the doctor says, oh, you don't have a bacterial infection. I mean, these are, I think this is part of what your comment is about, if I understand it correctly, and I would agree. I think I'm agreeing.
Okay, we got one here, and then I'll be there in
a minute. We got a live one. Yeah, just to be on the negative of all of this, but we have to remember that in the last 100 years, our lifespans have increased because of the fact that we have vaccinated, we are washing things, or most of us wouldn't be here. So to keep it in control, definitely, you know, I'm pro this, because when it comes to your life, you're saying, hey, wait a minute, you know, it's good to say all these things here, oh, I want to keep the environment safe and all these varieties still going, but when it comes to my life, it says, hey, give me whatever you can get to make me well and live longer. So,
well, what do people die of now compared to what they died of 200 years ago?
Well,
right? No, your point is well taken.
We're just laughing because most people has a problem, even myself, with overweight. What are we eating? Wheat, and lots of it. And now it's GMOs, and now we're getting more and more of that. That's usually that, or smoking, other things that we all do.
So people die now of things like cancer, obesity,
correct,
you know, diabetes, and these kinds of things. And 200 years ago, people died of like accidents. They died of disease, predators, you know, those kinds of things. So our
absolutely
the whole our whole it's a bit of an off topic, but I mean certainly the patterns of mortality are completely different than they used to be.
Correct, but that's because we have put it all in check for the, you know what I mean, for what we have right now. So or we wouldn't be here.
And I would one of the interesting things about Ebola virus was that, and people were, oh, we need to get on top of Ebola, but actually it turns out that a really big determinant of ability to recover and survival was the public health and the condition of the patient. So when we started to see doctors and nurses who were being brought back who were in much better physical condition and were brought back to medical facilities in North America, they are surviving Ebola. So one of the things that was of course happening was that people were dying of Ebola because their living conditions were very stressful. So that plays a role.
When you have something new and it all of a sudden goes viral, you know what I mean? You're going to have to throw everything you had on that. And without having that, and that becomes your own decision of selection. Is it worth to let this thing go, or is it worth to save all these people? And, you know, if you want to go for saving all the people, or even here. Because if you had Ebola in Sudbury, you'd see a whole different mindset that comes about on that type of thing. So not only when it affects you personally, you all of a sudden change your thought process.
Thanks. Okay, we had a question in the back.
Question? Hi, I'll just try to express perhaps one of my greatest fears. We all understood what happened, around 500 years ago when the Europeans came to the New World, what happened with the indigenous people, because the two populations had been effectively separated by about 10,000 years after the Ice Bridge and Ice Age and so on. And the old world people had developed a bit of a resistance to smallpox and tuberculosis. The last two indigenous people in Newfoundland, one died of smallpox and the other of tuberculosis. So in that context, I'm watching on Discovery Channel or whatever, scientists bringing up from the deep seas animals, tube worms, and so on, which are thriving around sulfur vents and hot areas underneath the ocean and dissecting them. And I'm thinking these populations, say us in the terrestrial world and these deep sea organisms have been separated literally by hundreds of millions of years. And when I see this, I'm thinking that thing may be carrying a virus which could wipe us out in the matter of just a few months. Any comments on that?
As officially the least qualified person to answer this question, or a comment, okay, maybe I shouldn't. I'm going to take a crack at it anyway. So, like, you have to have a relatively close evolutionary history with parasites and pathogens for them to be able to take advantage of your, you know, your cellular circuitry. And so I think, you know, that's why, like, 10,000 years, that's a... I get, you know, that obviously was a problematic time period. I don't think that millions of years we're going to be in quite the same situation, especially because there aren't sort of versions of us down hanging around by those, like, sulfur, you know, vents that are kind of, like, co-evolving along with the pathogens. But now I'm going to give this to somebody who knows what they're talking about.
Just comment that. Actually, with climate change, we're more likely to see... diseases which are more tropical diseases, whether it's West Nile virus, which is now, of course, in southern Ontario, or the spread of, I was going to say, Lyme disease and our favorite little ticks, deer ticks. That's more likely what we're going to. I think if you're looking for the next parasite or disease, that's really what we would be looking to, is something that's further south. And we've been relying in Canada on the cold and the winters to protect us because things are dying. And of course, that circumstance is changing now. So yeah. I mean, and Lyme disease, it is spreading.
Yeah.
It is spreading.
Yeah. I don't think you have to worry about viruses from tube worms from down deep below. Yeah, I am. I don't think you have to worry about it.
But have you seen The Thing? We should be really worried about that.
I think there's lots of things to worry about, but I don't think you have to worry about, you know, a virus jumping from, you know, a tube worm that's being dissected by a biologist. I think there's too much evolutionary history between us and tube worms for viruses that are adapted for the immune system of a tube worm to be able to circumvent the immune system of a vertebrate. Now, having said that, I could be wrong, right? Which is possibly, quite possible. But unlikely, I think. I think quite correctly that Don's suggestion is that our biggest problem will be the migration of vectors that carry a lot of these parasites and pathogens like Lyme disease and things of that nature moving northward as temperatures warm. And I think that's exactly what you're seeing. I think the worry is with this Egyptian mosquito, right? That's in fact an invasive, but is moving northward because of climate change. And it carries a lot of different pathogens that that can infect people. And that's, I think, where your fears should be, I think.
Awesome. Okay, we had a question right here.
My question's a little bit more specific. With respect to the condors and the black-footed ferrets, did the biologists involved in the reintroduction, did they know that there was a possibility of the parasite going extinct? And if so, why didn't they keep a few infected ones and release them into the wild so that they could save both populations?
So, is there any veterinarians in this crowd? No? Good. Okay. So I'm going to tell you that research in zoos is driven by veterinarians. And veterinarians have a very different skill set than someone like me, like an animal ecologist. And I can assure you that those veterinarians had no idea that what was happening. And that their initial... interest was, of course, the health of the animals that they were asked to take care of, which were these, in this case, the ferrets, let's say. And that they Of course they deloused them, right? Like, what else would you do with an animal that you're bringing in? It's like your pet, right? That's what you do. You delouse it. You take care, you know, you get rid of all the ectoparasites. And so, you know, it wouldn't surprise me at all that they had no idea. And even if they had known, you know, what would they have done? So parasites are interesting because they often become very specific to their host species. And they become, they actually will speciate in the same pattern as their hosts. And so each host species is carrying a unique species of parasite. And so if they had been able to, you know, comb off some of these fleas, where would they have put them? Those fleas were adapted specifically for black-footed ferrets, let's say, and if you had put them on a domestic ferret, they would have died, or they might have died, at least.
Yeah, so like, couldn't they keep a certain population?
Yeah, they could have kept the fleas on the ferrets, yeah. Right? They could have, sure.
But like not all of them.
Well, they should have kept them, all of them, but yeah, then they could have, for sure. But I think, yeah, I blame the veterinarians. And in fact, if you, in all my dealings with veterinarians in a research context, almost always there's been problems.
Just make a follow up. So the interesting thing about head lice, because I was scratching, is anybody here who has kids will have seen head lice, and really they don't do anything bad to humans. We just don't like them. And now what's actually happened with the use of all of these shampoos and things like that, you've actually got pesticide-resistant head lice. And yeah, it's really like we're so obsessed with, I just think it's, you know, things live on other things and in other things, but we just don't like it.
I think there's also pubic lice. And in fact, pubic lice in human populations are declining. Right? There is an aesthetic that leads to the removal of pubic hair, and there's no pubic lice anymore. It's pretty interesting.
So
I swear to God, it's true.
I want to know who's going to start that petition to save the pubic lice. Any takers? Any takers at all? Okay.
Well, just a comment on the head lice. I think there are actually school boards in Southern Ontario that are stopping to remove kids from the school and keep them within the school on based on that argument that head lice have no harm whatsoever. Well, it doesn't go well with all the parents, of course. But I think going back to the veterinarians and actually the values that was the part of the early discussion, I think veterinarians have their own values that they put on the well-being of the animals. Ecologists, evolutionary ecologists have other values and other interests and what they believe is right to do. But when often when it comes to conservation, I think time is the essence. And we didn't really address when do we take those decisions? When do we know that the parasite we're going to kill on grass might not be good in 100 years from now? And often we, in a conservation context, we don't have the time to wait for more data and more science to come across. So should more science be done all the time and never any decision to be made and we lose species because we just didn't take any actions? Or do we just rely on the value we have and which one are good to use at that moment?
So can you hear me okay? So yeah, so there is a cost to taking your time to make a decision, for sure. And I guess what this brings to mind for me is the question of like how many options are you aware of when you're making these kinds of decisions? So like if the veterinarians indeed weren't just sort of taking into account the fact that they might be dealing with a population, a species that was about to go extinct, then they might not have taken the time to think, hey, is there some kind of low-cost, quick solution? Can we just take a bunch of these little buggers, throw them in a freezer for 10 years, and figure out if maybe we want to release them later when we release some of these animals back into their natural habitats, if that's a thing? I know that's going to be much more difficult in some cases than others, but it certainly is worth making some kind of a decision based on the information that we have, with the big old caveat that we have to be very conscious of the uncertainty that we're dealing with in all of those situations. But I don't know if that addresses...
That,
Yeah, I just think that there are always things that have to be bear in mind, always, like, what does the science have to say? Scientists have to be part of every single conversation. What are we valuing in these cases? Obviously, we don't have time to survey everyone, but there should be some, at least, deliberative decision-making process that's, like, written down and can be checked or something. It's part of forming a dialogue.
One could argue that if we didn't try to save the ferret, we would have lost both, the ferret and the lice.
Yeah, I'm glad that Albrecht got into some of the details, because I wasn't clear on how the process actually was done. But that they just came in, were deloused, thrown in.
What else did you do?
Yeah. Obviously there are other things you can do.
No, I know, but I'm just talking about the question.
Actually, we do have the International Convention on Biological Diversity, which says that biological diversity, whether it's genetic or ecosystem or species richness, should be preserved. So you actually do have some principles there. But of course, we all know that United Nations conventions are largely ignored. But there are these conversations there. But of course, when the rubber hits the road, how does it roll out at the local level? Usually not.
Okay.
I'm a United Nations supporter, just in case. And I'm
sorry.
Climate change is real. Okay.
It's okay. Everybody loves me. No? Well, I guess it's not really a question. That's okay. I was just going to speak just a little bit further to the ferret situation. I think if we think about that situation sort of holistically, the flea or the louse or what have you didn't lead to the endangerment of the ferret in the first place. That was a myriad other factors, including land use practice changes and agriculture and things like that. And so if we think of it that way, I mean, one solution would be that we make the trade-off and we stop those agricultural practices or we change them. But I think that we all know that in conservation context, that's not really the big sell to say, like, well, maybe you guys should stop farming. That's not really going to work. So in that case, I mean, the ferret presumably has some value in that it's part of the larger ecosystem. And so is it wrong to say the ferret, what it's doing in the ecosystem, we're not going to replace with another animal? What the louse is doing for the broader ecosystem perhaps can be done by another ectoparasite. Maybe in this case, this is a trade-off that we need to make so that we can all kind of coexist. She's a plant.
I think you're right. I agree. It's, yeah, yes, yes. Did you have something else to add?
So it sounds like there's two questions, right? There's kind of a biology question and then an ethics question, right? So yeah. I don't know.
And that's always going to be the question. That's always going to be the challenge. It's the what are the real drivers? So everything, usually there's multiple causes to what we're seeing. But often there are bigger causes and smaller causes. And in that bigger picture, the louse is really not a driver towards extinction. But how do you have that more difficult conversation about land use changes? And I would actually argue that this is where scientists, STEM, science, technology, engineering, math type people, have actually, over the last 20, 25 years, tended to seed that area of conversation about the values and the social drivers to, they've divested, we've given away a lot of that conversation, said, oh, we do the data, we do the science, and what people, and we're more neutral, and we're really objective, and we're gonna give the data that will inform the policy. And we're not allowed to have a political or policy decision, you know, because then we're compromising our neutrality. And in actual fact, it's not very long ago that scientists, like STEM scientists, because social scientists are scientists too, you know, the caveats there, but people who study biology and physicists were very much in the forefront of these debates about the political nature of the science research that they were doing. So in Harvard University, there were huge debates about molecular biology and the emerging field of genetic engineering in the, you know, in the 70s and 80s. Should they even be doing this? And nuclear physicists, of course, many of them were really against nuclear research because the implications for bombs. And I was actually at a very cool conference a couple of years ago at University of Massachusetts at Amherst called Science for the People. And they brought back a lot of these activist scientists from the 70s and 80s, and the science and technology studies grad students, the political science students, were interviewing them. And so there were like these nuclear physicists who'd been at Los Alamos and stuff, and they had FBI files on them, and you know they were all in like their 70s and 80s, and one of their comments was, well, in the past, scientists, people like some of us here, we had political opinions and we talked about what the science meant for society, but nowadays what you're seeing is there are these political scientists and social scientists, and they're commenting on the role of science. And that's why one of the really important things that Albrecht and Gillian are doing is you have to have these interdisciplinary teams so you can have people from diverse areas having that conversation, because there is nothing more annoying to me as a scientist to hear a bunch of my colleagues go, oh, I'm not going to take a position on women in science and technology because I don't know anything about that, or I just get the research grants. And I'm like, dude, you know, somebody makes a decision. This is political and it's policy. And you actually can be a scientist and you can have that conversation about these values without necessarily compromising your ability to do research. You can wear these different hats. You can have a political view, you can have a policy view, you can have a scientist view, and it's actually okay, but you need to have that conversation. And I think that in regaining that ground, we really have to look to the help of our social sciences and philosophy colleagues to give us the confidence to have that conversation and reclaim some of that. So you should be having those conversations, and they are uncomfortable conversations because you're talking about people's values, but you should not have those conversations. And maybe that's really what you would, sorry, I'm taking too much time here, but I'm just saying that scientists, it's okay to say there are these difficult conversations and I might want to talk about land use change or these other drivers. Yeah, sorry, does that make sense?
Okay, far from apologizing, that was quite a rousing defense of science, actually, I think so. That calls for a round of applause, I think.
Are there any human-specific parasites you can think of that would be beneficial to reintroduce, or have we kind of all wiped them out by now?
Interesting question.
Smallpox. We need more smallpox. Just kidding. I'm kidding.
We are recording this for posterity.
She wants more pubic lice. I don't know if we can, to my mind, there's nothing that comes to the top of my head. But, you know, we can speak again about this sort of autoimmune, so the prevalence of autoimmune disease. And, we don't have intestinal worms, for example. So human populations have co-evolved with intestinal worms, right? So in lots of developing countries, people are infected with intestinal worms, and our immune systems are adapted to fight these things off. And we don't have them anymore. And so there's a large prevalence of inflammatory bowel disease that's presumably the result of our immune systems going haywire because they don't have anything to fight. And so there's, you know, should we reintroduce gut worms to human populations in Western countries? I don't know, but certainly they're being used. I mean, I mentioned already earlier that they're being used to treat some of these conditions. So, oh, there's also fecal transplants. She wants me to talk about fecal transplants. So, yeah, so they're a thing, yeah. So,
at least, you know, I'm not the only one talking about poop here. That's good.
No, so it's actually an interesting point. Our gut, so the microbiome is the community of microbes that live on your body. Your gut carries a specific microbiome, and the microbiome of people that live in Western countries that eat a Western diet are actually profoundly different from hunter-gatherers and other cultures. And so one argument is that part of sort of the difficulties we have in terms of obesity and some of the diabetes and some of these other issues might be because we have a microbiome that's less diverse and is missing several types of microorganisms that our bodies are adapted to be working with. And even like things, so the fecal transplant comes from the fecal transplant comes from people who are infected with C. difficile, for example. C. difficile being colonized by C. difficile. So just so you know, C. difficile is a bacteria that colonizes your gut. Often you pick it up in a hospital setting, and it can cause, you know, lots of pathology and even death. And people have a hard time often getting rid of it. Antibiotics don't always work, and anyways, one of the ways to restore the quote-unquote balance of your gut microbiome is to shove somebody else's crap up your butt. And so you end up with my new microbes. This is what a fecal transplant is. It's called a fecal transplant. And in fact, that seeds a healthy quote-unquote microbiome into your own gut, and that ultimately leads to a reduction in the amount of C. difficile that's in your gut, and you end up being healthier. Oh, they do, right? Yeah. Well, I'll let you. Okay. So, do-it-yourself fecal transplant is not recommended here. Anyway, the point being that there are part of living in a Western country and Western sort of standards of hygiene have led to some of these imbalances, quote unquote, that might be causing health problems, right? And so we've driven so many parasites and pathogens to extinction in our own sort of day-to-day life that this causes some of these sort of autoimmune problems and things of that nature.
Other questions from the floor?
I can't remember the exact details, and somebody here may remember it, but it has something to do with the evolution of kissing. Something it has to do with transferring microbial the benefits of the microbial community from mouth to mouth. There could be an evolutionary benefit to kissing that is related to your microbiome. I'm sure I read that somewhere. Am I getting it wrong? Did anyone?
Line up, guys.
Does anyone? I saw some research. Does anyone remember this? It's like from a year to 2 years ago. Did it? I'm sure I read something about this, and I was like, ew.
But it sounds plausible to me, and honestly, it doesn't make it less appealing, really. Like, it's just kind of cooler, I think. So. Other questions from the floor? No? I'm a little bit curious about the value option that you mentioned, Gillian. I was wondering if you might just be able to, or sorry, the option value. Yeah, thank you. I was wondering if you could just
I want to direct everyone's attention to a talk that was given in our Thinking Extinction Symposium that Brett and the rest of SEEK, but mainly Brett, organized. We had a fellow from New Zealand named James McLaurin in the philosophy department give a talk on different ways you can measure biodiversity, and he talked about option value. So if you go to the SEEK YouTube channel, his talk is there if you're interested in learning more about this in more detail. Or you can read his book, Biodiversity. It's really good. The option value idea is something that Don brought up today, and I think you did on the radio as well. The idea being, if not this one, then your quirks and quirks talk. But the idea being that you just don't know what these organisms do. and you don't necessarily, and this is, you know, this was brought up also, and you also don't necessarily know what they could do in the future. There's this idea of having this. So is that a saying or is that a?
Yeah, the cure for cancer is in the rain. That's why you have to. So
this would be okay. So there's an argument for not cutting down rainforests, which is the cure for cancer is in the rainforest. Like you just don't know what you're losing in terms of biomedicines or whatever is there. We really don't know. I mean, I think that. What really is coming out with the new forms of genetic sequencing and the taxonomy that's arising from this is there is a lot more biodiversity than our simplistic methods for identifying species previously were able to show us. And that's why I think the most telling example of this for me is that I'm teaching botany, which is basically the survey course. We teach everything but animals. So when you do plant biology, you cover fungi, bacteria, protists, you name it, just because the animals get all taught in the animals course, whatever. Okay, I could rant about this for a while because I'm a plant ecologist, but I teach fungus. Anyway, but basically, the new tree of life, so it's changing so rapidly in terms of how we are seeing the evolution of life in the different groups, that even the 8th edition of this textbook, the plant biology textbook, is already out of date. So I had some students saying, could I use the 7th edition? I can get it for $30. I was like, yeah, go on, use it. I'll just make sure I give you all the slides for the information that's changed into the 8th edition. So, of course, the main thing that's changed is the taxonomy and systematics, how we see the organization of life on Earth. But what was so interesting, and I said, oh, and by the way, everybody, that figure that's in the 8th edition that you all just paid like $150 for because it's really expensive, that's out of date too, because it's changing so rapidly because of the new techniques that we have. And I think this, for me, is perhaps one of the most compelling reasons to try and hold on to biodiversity, because we really know so little about it, I think. I mean, that's what I'm taking from this kind of new research.
And when people make that argument, are they saying it could be helpful for us as humans later on?
It's always helpful for us. That's how most people see the world.
Yeah, I think most conservation arguments that people make, especially policymakers, but generally, unless you're sort of a philosopher, you know, most of the arguments that people make are based on utility calculus for us, personally, humans. So it is worth bearing in mind, though, like when you have the option of, or when you want to preserve the option of maintaining a certain kind of biodiversity, who or what has to pay for that? So if it is the case that you have to destroy lives or well-being. I mean, even if you think about the analogy to language preservation, like we all understand, most of us understand that there's a great deal of cultural information that's embedded in languages. It's an important communication mechanism between people of different generations. There's a lot of reasons to preserve these languages that are going extinct across the planet, but you can't download the responsibility for preserving these languages on the populations who speak them without a lot of support, because it can be incredibly burdensome for them to maintain these as living languages. Similar arguments can be made for species. Do we really want to download the burdens of preserving biodiversity onto particular human populations or animal populations or individual organisms? And of course, every time you delay making a decision, it costs something as well.
I just said to Albrecht, and of course we have to remember that 99.9% of all species that ever existed have gone extinct. But he didn't want to say that. So yeah, extinction, sorry?
I don't want to be the bad guy.
He doesn't want to be the bad guy. Yeah. 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 Episodes of mass extinction. I mean, this is, and this is where we always say, oh yes, most species are extinct. I guess the I guess I don't want to be part of a species that caused another mass extinction. That would be, so when we're talking about the perspective from humans, I would rather like try to do something to change that, knowing that most species will be extinct. I shouldn't have said that, should I? That they're reminding extinction. Extinction is
it,
real.
It was a bit of a downer, yeah. We talk about these big picture questions in science and society, and then we're always like, oh, man, we're in trouble. That's it's a bad way to end it. But does anybody have any kind of last comments or questions? No? Any last comments from our panel? Was there one more? Yeah.
Just in conclusion.
Make it awesome.
Yeah. In conclusion, can we really destroy biodiversity as a human? You know what I mean? We might destroy one, but in a million years, it'll come back in its same form or in multiple forms afterwards. What do you think?
Yeah, well, I mean, so great, grand extinctions are great for having biological diversification. I mean, evolution goes nuts, and creates all kinds of diversity after you kill everything. But this is why it does always come back to us, right? That's not useful to us at all. You know, we're going to be in a lot of trouble for a number of reasons. I mean, not just losing the option value, like if we can even survive, that's the whole thing. Usually it doesn't have to, but there are different kinds of frameworks for evaluating the ethics of these situations. One of them would be kind of the traditional conservation framework. At least the one that's employed by decision makers and scientists tends to be very cost-benefit based, and it does tend to be based upon the interests of humans primarily. But philosophers are divided on these things.
So. Okay, well, I guess we'll wrap up there. Oh, goodness. I'm going to move, because I don't want to talk to that speaker, so I'm going to stand over here. I just wanted to say in conclusion to, first of all, thank you all so much for coming. This is really fun. It's been a couple months since our last Science Cafe, so it's nice to kind of get back in the room. I want to say a huge thanks to Gillian and Albrecht for helping to organize it and for Seek for partnering with us. It's they're a fantastic, fantastic partner, and we are already planning our next event together, so look out for that next year. And a big thanks to Dawn for coming up and for speaking with us. It was just absolutely fantastic. Did you guys want to say anything at all?
I have to say something. We're talking about poop, and you know what? One of the first papers that I ever published in the peer-reviewed literature was on goose poop. So you know what? Gosh, it always comes back to this, really, doesn't it? And you just have to remember, here's a parting rhyme for you to remember for everybody. You are what you eat minus what you excrete. Remember that.
That's fantastic. And you know, Don, if you want to study goose poop, you are always... No, Don, you're always welcome to come and do some field work on the grounds of Science North near Ramsey Lake. If anybody's ever come down and tried to spread out a picnic blanket around Canada Day, you know we have lots of goose poop. So yeah, it's perfect. That's awesome. I like that little rhyme. I'm going to use that. We have another Science Cafe coming up on, it's going to be March 30th, is our second of three for this season. So that one's in partnership with the School of Human Kinetics at Laurentian University. And the topic is on, is exercise the best medicine? So it should be a really interesting conversation. Would you take an exercise prescription from your doctor? So it should be really cool. We have a bunch of really great profs from Laurentian and from Cambrian, and we've got some people coming out of town, including a physician and Olympic rower, so that should be really cool. There's also a Nightlife on the Rocks event that's coming up, an adult night at Science North, so if you want to drink a beer and make some paper airplanes, that's something that you can do on March 11th. It's a make and mingle. We've got a really cool exhibit on right now about creativity and building stuff. But yeah, until then, I hope we'll see you guys back here next month for our second of three Science Cafes. Please do fill out the evaluation forms on your sheets, because that's the best way that I know whether to do a certain topic again or do something a little different. So yeah, let me know. And if you guys don't have anything else to add, then that's it. That's all. So everybody drive safe, and hope we'll see you at the end of March. Thanks.